Hey guys, welcome to the Quick Talk Podcast, the only show handcrafted for small business entrepreneurs looking to explode their business. It's time to get your mind right so you can get your grind right. Are you ready?
The ability to divorce yourself from the chaos of the moment, because there's always chaos in the moment, especially the small business owner.
Hello, and thank you for hanging out with me today. My name is Joshua Latimer, and my mission is to deliver you, the listener, power-packed, no-fluff business insights by some of the small business success stories from all over the world. And today, we have a very interesting guest. I'm joined by Keith Kalfas from Kalfas Services up in Michigan, my old stomping grounds. And just 5 years ago, Keith, he had nothing, okay? He was dead broke, working a no good job, and was at the lowest of the lows, literally. And less than 60 months later, he's put together a successful landscaping and window cleaning business doing over six figures. He has a YouTube channel rocking out a quarter of a million views a month with over 10,000 subscribers. He's even created some online learning tools to help young guys get started in the business. Keith, how you doing out there today?
Very well, Josh. Thanks for having me on.
Oh, it's my pleasure to have you on. Actually, we went years, Keith, when I was running my window cleaning business without connecting. It's not until after I moved to Costa Rica that I realized that you had such an incredible story and you're doing a lot of interesting things. And now we're reconnecting when I'm like 3,000 miles away from you, which is kind of weird. But, you know, I want to hop right into it here, Keith. Tell us a little bit about your story and some of the background.
All right. And started out young, pushing a lawnmower at the age of 9, 10 years old, working with my father and his lawn care service during the summer out of school for $4 a lawn. Outside getting fresh air. And very quickly I started understanding that if you want to go in the mall and get anything you want as a kid, a football, a bicycle, you're going to have to pay for it yourself, because I came from a very humble beginnings. So I started working at a very young age.
I think a lot of guys can relate to that too. I mean, I came from nothing. I was the first entrepreneur in my family. I was entrepreneurial even as a young guy too. I don't know if you started any businesses when you were a kid or if maybe that light bulb didn't come on till later, but I think it's a lot of guys listening right now had that work ethic drilled into them at a young age.
I always was creative as a young kid and had entrepreneurial ideas, but I was repeatedly having the negativity and brainwashing pounded into my head of something that was from a past age, which is, go to school, work hard, get good grades, get a good job, get a degree, stick it up on the wall and get a safe, secure job somewhere, get something in a factory or something that was kind of pushed on me as a kid. And I was very rebellious to that idea. I didn't like the idea of it. I just wanted to do my own thing. Kind of being at the age of a 14-year-old kid, putting my groceries in the house and having to help support the family because I don't want to get too deep into the hard times we came from, but it was a pretty dysfunctional Metro Detroit type of family. And I know that's very common now. So,
well, yes, I want to drill down into what I think is an incredible insight that you just gave. And first of all, people that come from working class families, which a lot of us entrepreneurs come from, they don't, and it's not their fault, but they don't understand that the trade your time for dollars mentality that permeates your entire youth, your entire adolescence, the get a job, get the degree, go work in a cubicle, that mentality, right? Which seems normal. They don't realize how far away that is from the real recipe for success. On this show, we talk a lot about automation and about putting systems in place that can building cash machines, turning your business into a thing that gives to you, not something that you have to give to your business all the time. And I just think that you're opening up a can of worms that a lot of people can relate to. And it's the concept of trading your time for dollars and working harder is the answer to success, but it's really not, is it, Keith? I mean, it has more to do with working smarter.
You're getting me excited already because At the peak of my frustration, I was the guy who would stay up all night, as a young kid, trying to reverse engineer things and researching and reading books. And then Anthony Robbins came on late night infomercials. And funny thing is, when I would, started getting into the whole motivational tapes, what did Uncle Bobby say, who worked at a factory or the steel plant in Detroit or something? Oh, those guys got rich by writing those books of telling you how to get rich. That's a scam, blah, blah, blah. Just negative crap, man. But I knew that there was an authenticity and a spirit about what Anthony Robbins or these other gurus were talking about. And I couldn't help it. I was broke, so I was paying my buddy, who was good at the internet at that time, way back in the days of piracy, and I was paying him $20-$30 out of my paycheck to download these Anthony Robbins and these different programs that I could put and burn onto disc. I had an old disc man. I even had a cassette tapes burning through batteries, and I started spending money on education because I wasn't learning the stuff in school that I really wanted to learn. So here I am now, 19, 20 years old, a foreman, supervisor, crew leader, running landscape crews for $15 an hour, just working my butt off, man, out in the sun. And instead of listening to these loud lawnmowers all day and machines and guys talking about stupid stuff, I was listening to Brian Tracy, Zig Ziglar, Anthony Robbins, Deepak Chopra, Wayne Dyer. By the time I was 25, I had read over 300 books on audio.
Wow.
And at the age of 25, I was still in a dead-end job, jumping from company to company, and I had nowhere or no money or no mentors that I could go out and calibrate that energy and immediately apply it to a real-world situation or business. It was all stuck in my head. I actually had a nervous breakdown because I had all this information in my head, and I knew it was real. But everywhere I looked around me, I couldn't see it in reality. I just saw broke, negative, victim-minded people, and I was actually one myself.
You know, that's a powerful thing that you just brought up. I think, the deal is you were going through that phase where you were information loading. You were harvesting and gathering information. You were an info junkie. You were craving the positivity that you weren't seeing, in maybe the employee world, but the kind of positivity and the hope that you can only find in the entrepreneurial world, and you knew it was real, but you didn't know how to execute on it. Is that right? It sounds like you didn't know how to put the pieces together. You knew that there was something to it, but you didn't have any support system in place to help you understand how to actually build a system or a business and how to make it work.
Absolutely. What happened was I literally had a nervous breakdown. I believe that there's a power in the vulnerability to talk about this type of stuff, because behind every strong entrepreneur or businessman, I just think if you sit them down for a few hours on the couch and you talk to them, you will start to see somebody who came from or will start admitting that, hey, man, I've had struggles and failures. I've had frustrations. I've come from a broken family, and I made it because I started surrounding myself with this is what they would probably say. They surrounded themselves with like-minded people and started right. Getting away from the negative vampires.
I love the passion, and I think it'll translate well to our listeners because let's start with this: nature versus nurture. I mean, it's true. I mean, if the environment that you're exposed to has a tremendously profound impact on the way that you think. One of my slogans, and even in the intro to this podcast, is get your mind right so you can get your grind right. It's kind of cheesy, but it's I have fun with it. But the underlying principle is true, is that if you have the correct thinking, then you can take action and do the correct types of things. And when you have that negativity around you, like you did and like I did, a lot of people do, it's really, really, really hard. And there's a lot of time that has to pass by before you really believe in yourself. And there's a huge difference. My big takeaway from what you said is there's a huge difference between knowing that success is possible and knowing that you are possible of doing that success. It's one thing for Tony Robbins to do it, but can Keith do it? Can Josh do it? In my early days, I couldn't even have dreamed about doing $10,000 a month. When I first started, I thought, man, the day I do $10,000 a month, that I'll have made it. That'll be the final frontier. Well, it happened a lot quicker than I thought, and I had to raise that level of thinking. And you know, today, you know, doing $500,000 a month doesn't intimidate me at all. It's nothing. It's just, it's because that level of thinking, that level of confidence because of life experience and surrounding myself with the right people, and it helps lift you up. Is that kind of what you mean?
Absolutely. Growing from inside. You got to make changes on the inside before they happen on the outside, and that's not easy.
Well, let's talk a little bit about your business. You know, let's get a little more specific into Kelfis Services and kind of what you guys are doing. I know you mentioned when we talked before that you're doing about 70% landscaping, 30% window cleaning. They're kind of, you know, complementary services. You're already at the customer's home. It's the same type of kind of demographic kind of thing. So I could see how that could be a good fit. I mean, What's the biggest mistake that you think you've made, you know, specifically with that business, you know, since you've started it? You know, it's on a rocket ship rise. It's doing well, but you've had to have some pain along the way. What do you think the biggest mistake is?
Biggest mistake was not going into business for myself sooner so I can learn all these stinging, painful lessons that force you to man up and grow up and face the fire. The biggest mistake was not going into this sooner.
Yeah, absolutely. I always say pain is an excellent teacher. I have a bachelor's degree in pain and a PhD in suffering, right?
Yeah, I'm going to use it.
Yeah. Well, what area of your business right now, I mean, do you think could use maybe a little more automation or a little more systems? Is there a particular division of your company, maybe sales, operations, you know, following up with the customer, anything? What do you think your focus is going to be the rest of this year as far as kind of building your machine?
You know, that's a great question, and it's awesome that you asked that because it presses one of my hot buttons. The interesting thing about being a small business owner is you're the chief cook and bottle washer. You're wearing all the hats. For some reason, I love marketing and I'm obsessed with it. I'm naturally good at selling and talking, but I actually personally struggle with systems and protocols and systematizing my business. I definitely would like to pursue coaching and taking time off and putting my business down to less hours and more operating the business from the top from within.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of guys are exactly where you're at with that. I mean, you have a lot of passion in what you're doing. Your business is growing quickly. You have a lot of followers that, you know, are really loving the positivity and you love to help people. But you, like a lot of people, and me, for a large portion of my business, you get stuck working in your business and you don't have time to work on your business. And there's a variety of reasons that happens. Sometimes people are perfectionists, or sometimes they can't seem to let themselves trust someone else to do the job right, or whatever the case is. But, you know, I think recognizing that that's the next step is a huge thing, because a lot of guys never even get to that point. And, you know, that's really when the business turns the corner and becomes a real blessing to you and your family, is when it starts to serve you rather than you serving it. Are you looking for a simple way to get more sales, more referrals, and strengthen your customer loyalty? Look no further than sendjim.com. It was handcrafted for you as a powerful tool that will automate your follow-ups after the sale. Imagine being able to stay in contact with your customers all year long by pushing a single button on your smartphone. This is a space age warp speed technology, and it will eliminate the chaos inside your business caused by trying to properly follow up with all of your leads and customers. Sign up for a free trial with no credit card required at sendjim.com right now. What are you waiting for?
You know, why do you think that so many small businesses fail? I asked Chris Lambertini's this when I interviewed him. He had some interesting insights, but you know, the failure rate on small businesses is like, it's like astronomical. I need to look this up, but it's like, isn't it like 50% or 60% of businesses fail within 24 months or something? What's going on?
I don't know. I've only, from what I've researched and what I've studied, I know there are people that dabble. They bounce around when something's not working. They don't stick to it. They want to bounce to the next thing, and they're running around scrambling.
If you could start over with your business, right, with all the knowledge that you have now, right, you've went through the pain, you went through the suffering. If you could push a reset button, not that you'd want to, but if you had to, if you could start over, what would you do differently the next time around?
I would take more time and conscientiousness in building my business plan. It's all about the plan. Even if you have a plan that's only 50% there, it's better than no plan.
Absolutely.
I spent my last semester in college not paying attention, or the last couple of weeks before I left, writing out a 17-page business plan thoroughly, and then I went out and executed it, and everything in the plan came to fruition. It all worked. So if I could press the reset button, I would spend a lot more time planning and analyzing and writing more drawn-out and detail-oriented systems and protocols and probably a 5 to 10 year plan.
Yeah, I mean, you're hitting one of my hot-button issues now. You know, the ability to zoom out, get a bird's eye view, and to reverse engineer. You actually said that phrase earlier. That's one of my big, big things that I push is reverse engineering, beginning with the end in mind. If you could start over with your business and build out a strong infrastructure from day one, I think a lot of people, they don't even have a clue how, it'd be like an atom bomb of awesomeness going off for their company. It would make a humongous difference, but sometimes it's hard to see that because you're busy in the day to day and you're putting out fires. A lot of small business guys, they're actually firefighters. They go from one issue to the next and they never have time to systematize their business. And I definitely get it. And another big misconception, Keith, I don't know if you struggled with this, but it's an overwhelming thought to try to, you know, build out the infrastructure for your entire company. It's not something you can do in a weekend. This is a major amount of work, and it freaks people out, and so they never do anything. They don't take action. And I try to teach people when I work with companies to start with what I call an MVS, a minimum viable system. It doesn't have to be extensive. It doesn't have to be complicated. It doesn't have to be long. Just start with something. Put something in place that improves your business today rather than yesterday. Listen up. Now, remember, being self-employed is not the same as being a business owner. And if you are looking for a way to automate your business and build yourself a clear path to the dream that keeps eluding you, then check out my online small business bootcamp. It's a go at your own pace. It's power-packed. It's a mind bomb. It will help you understand exactly how to architecture out and systematize your small business right now so you can finally be back in control. Go to windowwealth.com right now and check it out. Use the code MINDBOMB to save 30%. It's time to invest in yourself. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. And I want to add to it the power of habit. It's the ability to divorce yourself from the chaos of the moment, because there's always chaos in the moment, especially as a small business owner. I could tell everybody right now the most powerful thing you can do to be more effective is go in and turn off the notifications on your Facebook, the notifications on your Twitter, turn off your text message notifications so it doesn't beep when it goes off, put your phone on silent, put your phone on block mode from 6 to 10 p.m. or whatever that time of productivity is for you, and block out the noise, block out the negative people, the family members, anybody, whatever it takes so you can get that state of silence. You're going to get guilt tripped. The world, it's going to feel like is attacking you when you start chasing your dream or trying to get that solitude. But when you do it, an amazing thing happens. You start to carve out a trench where water starts flowing, and that water turns into a rushing river. And before you know it, you have momentum that nobody else around you was able to achieve because you took that time out for yourself. You were selfish.
Selfish is an interesting way to put that, you know, because I would call it intentional, you know, because this falls into the execution category, in my opinion. A lot of guys, it's not that they don't know what to do. It's not that they don't know how to be successful. They might not have all the answers, but they know enough stuff right now to enhance their lives and their business. But the problem is that nobody actually does it. They don't do it, which is also known as execution. And it's not an easy thing. I'm not making light of it. Execution's hard for all of us, but you're right. If you're intentional with your day, if you structure the daily activities that need to be done in order of importance or however you do it, but most importantly, make sure that they get done, then obviously you're going to make huge progress, or like you said, build a trench, get some momentum going. Now, you mentioned also... You mentioned that you're a reader and that you read a lot of books. And so I love quotes. What's your favorite quote, Keith?
It would be Anthony Robbins. The quality of your life is in direct proportion to the amount of uncertainty that you can comfortably live with. By Anthony Robbins.
That's
good. You just really, marinate on that. The quality of your life is in direct proportion or direct correlation to the amount of uncertainty you can comfortably live with. Now ask yourself that question or say that quote when you're going through hell or something just messed up in your business, or now something's costing you money and you're working 2 days for free and you're very uncomfortable and very uncertain. You don't know what's going to happen moment to moment and you're cracking up, and say, aha, the quality of my life right now and every day, moment by moment, is in direct proportion to the amount of uncertainty, which is happening right now, that I can comfort. Can I live with this? Am I going to make it through this? Have I made it through this before? Why? Yes. Why? Because I'm the type of person who makes it through this stuff. And right. I believe a business owner staying calm and emotionally intelligent, despite all the suffering and the pain, is the one who makes it out.
Wow, that's a great quote. And, you know, that guy is just, he's legendary for quotes, no doubt about that. Tony Robbins is world famous, and what a great thinker and a great business mind. That quote actually parlays really nicely into the next question, which is, what role does fear play in the minds of business owners? And this is a deep question, and it can go a lot of directions, but I know for me, my best work is done when I have a knot in my stomach. You know, the biggest things that I accomplish happen when my back's against the wall, you know, and I think sometimes that fear is a deterrent to push forward. But really it could be a motivator to push forward. What do you think? How does that mess with the heads of small business owners?
I could go in a million different directions here and just go off on a rant. I recommend reading, and it's not a religious book. It's more of a metaphor. Napoleon Hill wrote another book next to Think and Grow Rich that wasn't released for several years after, and it was called Outwitting the Devil. I've read this book 6 or 7 times, especially in the beginning of my business when I was in fear and I was terrified. He basically says, you know, if you let fear consume you and you stray, I mean, you're done, you're toast. It's the ability to act in spite of fear, and it can feel like you're walking a tightrope over fire or over alligators eating you alive and ripping mm-hmm. you apart in those specific moments.
That's right. And I have 3 sons and a new baby girl. I might just throw that in there. But my 3 boys,
congratulations.
Thank you very much. I'm a proud dad. I talk to my boys a lot about, you know, courage and bravery and all these epic stories and David and Goliath stuff. And one thing I try to emphasize with them is being brave or having courage does not mean that you're not scared. It doesn't mean that you don't have fear. Fear is always there, but it's your ability to move forward. It's your ability to execute and to take action, even though you feel that way, that really separates successful people from not as successful people. And I think that's true in sports. It's true in business. It's true in history. You know, I want to move right along here, Keith. And you have some crazy YouTube stuff going on. Whatever way you pulled this off, I don't know. I'm not a YouTube expert, but you got a ton of activity over there. You're the number one search result for a variety of terms. How do you have time for that? How is that going? How does that play into your daily routine? How important is that?
Nobody taught me any of this. I couldn't find this information anywhere. I looked on YouTube and I found a couple things, but nothing was talking about what I was going through and what I had to go through and the hell that I went through. I said, you know what? I'm going to start a YouTube channel. I'm going to put my message out there and start talking to guys who are going through the same thing I was and talk about the story of the struggle to the triumph. I started making videos, and then I started just becoming addicted to it once people started subscribing and commenting and say, wow, I feel the same way.
You saw a need and you filled that need. I mean, the fact that you're genuine, it shows, and people relate with that. And whether you have $10 million in net worth yet or not, your thinking is in line with what's going to get you there, and your passion is in line with what people need. I think you have a really interesting story, Keith. That's why I wanted to bring you on. How can they the listeners get a hold of you?
The name of my YouTube channel, go on YouTube, type in The Landscaping Employee Trap. That's the name of my YouTube channel. You'll find it very quickly. Go on, subscribe to me. Check out all my free videos and content. Tons of stuff over a diverse level of topics, but all pretty much revolving around small business. I've also put out a popular book recently this year, and that's doing great and getting a lot of great feedback from it. It's called How to Start a Landscaping Business Right Now with No Startup Money. And then also I launched over the past few months, depending on when you're listening to it now, completely live, is my business training course on how to start a landscaping business or any small business. That's in the link in the description below all my YouTube videos.
If you are looking to start a landscaping business or get some insight on how to make yours a little better, guys, Keith is the guy that you might want to turn to for that. Go to YouTube, The Landscaping Employee Trap, and he's right when he says he pops right up. He's not hard to find at all. Keith, thank you so much for joining us. Have a great night. God bless you, buddy.
Thanks, Josh. Shout out to you, man. Have fun in Costa Rica, and thank you, everybody, for listening, and have a blessed night.
Hey, thanks for hanging out, friends, and from all of us here at the Quick Talk Podcast team, we hope you loved today's show. We hope that you were inspired to become a doer and not just a listener. Apply what you've heard today in your own business and watch things change for the better. Lastly, remember that all the money in the world can't save your soul. Seek first the kingdom of God, my friends. We'll see you next time.
For more information about the Quick Talk Podcast or Joshua's other businesses, visit our website, quicktalkpodcast.com. Have a blessed day.